Well, it's really great that all of you are sticking with this, right? Tremendous, because this is what it takes. In the afterlife, after we drop the body here, it's actually more difficult, much more difficult. It's actually easier here, to recognize and accept than in the afterlife. So this is our opportunity, not after we die. Then it becomes more difficult, actually. So put in the work now, and this is your opportunity. This is your opportunity. Now, the world is, the consciousness of the world is such that it's tricky, to say the least. Keep throwing curveballs at me, you know, but we are absolutely going in the right direction, very fast, very fast. What else can we do? So, welcome to July 2nd. I slept in today. I had this dream, and I was in this building, and suddenly. Everybody was running through the exit and exiting quickly. I was all alone, and someone screamed, there's a shooter. And previously, there had been a security guard that had come and checked things, and I saw he had a pistol on his hip and a back brace too. And for some reason, they were screaming, there's a shooter. I don't know if this is an event in the world or what's going on exactly. I did see that they ran out into the darkness. It was very dark outside. Interesting. Are people conditioned? They've lively conditioned themselves, perhaps. See, anybody that's awakened, they try to stampede and scream, you know, fire, 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 like that. So, what we've been able to do is clearly see that our attempt is to stabilize hallucination by fixating the mind. And we believe if we don't do that, we'll be annihilated. Okay. So anyone who gives up, who realizes that the mind cannot be fixated, and in fact, nothing's ever happened in terms of crystallization or fixation of attention. It's never taken place. We've never fallen asleep, actually. We're pretending to be asleep. We're pretending to not be awake. But we're actually, all of us are actually awake. None of us have crystallized or fixated in the slightest bit. Anyone who realizes that will be seen by the world to be advocating annihilation, you know, like that. A shooter is trying to annihilate us, that kind of thing. And be careful of the rajistic energy in stampeding you. In the dream, it was both men and women, but the women were yelling the loudest, you know, screaming, you know, getting emotional, hysterical, like danger, you know, like screaming to a baby, you know, get out of the way, it's terrible danger, like that. And that we tend to react to that. They tend to be more vocal with more piercing cries and that, like that. So we could be easily stampeded by that rajistic energy. That is very, very active and emotive, and is really, really forcefully believing that yes, we can fixate the mind. That we know how to do it. We know how to do it. If the men say, "Well, we're not so sure," the women will say, "Oh, yes, we are. We know. We definitely can. Look, we have babies. We fixate the mind. We know how to fixate the mind." Like that. So at the core of it is this idea of having babies, thinking that this is fixating the mind. It's not. Okay, so we need to get to this. This is a sensitive point. Many people might yell, "Shooter," and run out of the building. So I was looking at that yesterday evening, and this morning when I woke up having babies, children, we think that a mind is being created. Not true at all. Not true at all. Our play of attention we may be invited to say, hey, this can fixate your mind. I have this flesh form that can fixate your mind, fixate your attention. And I'm sure it can do that. And since we're trying to fixate our attention, these babies are presented to us as, this is the way, this is custom made for you to fixate your attention. And since that's our goal, we say, oh great, I'm going to identify with this, and hopefully this body will be able to fixate my attention. But it never does. It never actually does. It never succeeds. How about that? That in itself is like quite shocking, you know, to hear that. So we're having this mandala consciousness, which is able to look at the whole situation differently and realize that nothing has ever succeeded in fixating our attention, but we believe our greatest effort is babies. Okay. And that these babies are custom designed to bring you on a path as you identify with them, as you hold your attention there, that the mother knows how to raise the baby in such a way that it will end up fixating your attention. And they try their best. They're very confident. Yes, this certainly will work. I'm sure it will work. I've committed to this working. But committing to the impossible, what is that? Does that mean then it's possible? Does committing to the impossible mean that the impossible is now possible? What power do we have through commitment to change reality? So we never know out of the blue what we're going to say may trigger, you know, tremendous recognition. It's just like, oh my gosh. So it's better to, someone once said, it's better to stand up and, it's better to say something and maybe be mistaken than to say nothing at all. So we give it a try here. You know, we stand up and we say the best we can say. And who knows, out of the blue, it may really, really be powerful. I didn't know what I would say when I sat down here. But I said, I'm not going to just say nothing at all today. Let's give it a try. Because the experience I've had is that indeed, breakthroughs keep happening. They keep happening. I don't fully understand, recognize, or accept what Jesus has to say, for instance, in dialogue on awakening. But I come across more and more and more and more where I feel, oh yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. That's how I see it too. So there's certainly been breakthroughs and you could say trending in the right direction, absolutely. And the big breakthroughs I've had definitely align in a lot of ways with what's being said, not entirely, but he's using words. So and we're using words here too, but he's using words. And expressing in a certain way, we use words, styles are automatically inferred, right? But really, I don't hold them to any style. I do not hold them to any style. That's not fair. Because he's had different styles. Of course, in Miracles was different. Journey Beyond Words is different. Dialogue on Awakening is different. So obviously, depending on who he's speaking with, there's different styles arise. So why hold him to any one of those styles? It's not necessary. Not necessary. And ultimately, you know, we're working on our wowness, really, on wowing the fact that we don't need to do anything. I need do nothing because I never fixated. So it's not that we're trying to fix our fixation. Get this? So here's where we part ways with dualistic belief, which is virtually every belief that's taught in this world, ever has been taught, mostly, is the idea that something needs to be fixed, something needs to be changed, something needs to be done. And what we say emphatically is nothing at all needs to be done. That our mind has never fixated in any way. So this means that everything we've done to fixate the mind has been futile, which is true. It's been absolutely futile. Had no effect at all. It did not, even in the slightest bit, achieve the outcome that we committed to, that we were committed that it achieve, that it fixate the mind. Because we have believed that fixating the mind is our salvation. Wrongly believing that we hallucinated in order to save reality, by save God by creating a new reality because the old reality had died, something happened to it, an absence of wholeness. But that's a mistake, you see. It was our desire to be greater than God that we hallucinated an absence in reality, when in fact there is no absence in reality. So this we have to go over and over and over this. It's absolutely crucial. And keep in mind that going into the afterlife is not going to make it any easier at all. And I believe those people are screaming, shooter, shooter, shooter. They left the building. They went into the afterlife. In other words, they were the ones who were unwilling to work at this, and unwilling to have anybody in this world aware enough to help, you know, work on this. Someone who's accepted, I don't need to do anything. There's nothing that needs to be fixed at all. The mind doesn't need to be fixed at all. We just need just a simple recognition that why did we hallucinate? Oh, okay. See, that's why I hallucinated. Not because anything was wrong with the mind at all. Okay, and that's it. That's all that we need to see. And then we realize that we never accumulated any regret. We never accumulated any regret at all. We were trying to accumulate regret, but we never succeeded at it. We were committed to it, but the commitment doesn't mean that we can change reality. Committing to changing reality doesn't mean we can change reality. So here we go again, right? But again, those people seem to have fled the building out into pitch darkness, very severe darkness. And I just wondered, you know, were they not fleeing into the afterlife where it's much easier to stay deluded, actually? It's much easier to stay delusional in the afterlife. Whereas here, the suffering has much more of a bite to it. And you know, we feel much more pressed with our delusions, which is good. We suffer more here, which is great. Because that's like the thorn in our, you know, in our flesh, the pain and suffering drives us to say, hey, well, you know, this is something isn't right. I have to really look at this. So by all means, use our opportunity here, which this is the easiest place to wake up. Or not wake up, but it's the easiest place to recognize we never fell asleep. It's the easiest place to recognize we never fell asleep. We pretended to fall asleep, or we've been trying to fall asleep. So we've been imagining that we must have somehow fallen asleep, but even we haven't. We've fallen asleep would really mean that the mind has been fixated in some way. But it has never been fixated. It can't. Holding attention is not fixation of attention. Fixation of attention means there's some external force has changed the mind, has fixated. The mind is perfect freedom. It's incapable of fixation. It's incapable. Every moment is instantaneous, instantaneously free of all other moments. And so it's impossible to fixate one moment to another moment. However, we can instantaneously repeat moments over and over and over, have the same experiencing moment by moment by moment by moment. That's called holding the attention. But there's no force that's causing us to do this other than our own desire. But fixating the attention means there's some, we believe there's some external force, something that is actually has the power to cause the moments to be the same moment or similar, independent of our desire, the mind's desire to hold the attention. Okay? And that can never happen. That can never happen. But we believe we've put all our stock in babies, that babies can do it. That being born as a baby can, a human baby can fixate our attention, has the power to fixate our attention. That's the whole commitment. It's interesting because who ran out, I noticed, is co-eds, who are at the age of ready to become young mothers. And they scream, shooter, shooter, they ran out. In other words, they don't want to hear this because they believe that they're capable of producing fixation of the mind, that we've committed to this notion of mothers having babies, that this will fixate the mind, and this is our greatest hope. We've placed our greatest hope in that, which is why we have to look at this. Without looking at motherhood and babies, we will remain, you know, in this committed to delusion, believing it's possible. You cannot have this sacred cow there. They say, well, we can't look at that. Because that's the heart of our commitment. Our belief is that mothers can produce babies that can bring about the fixation of the mind. That's our greatest hope, that we can avoid what we think is annihilation. So we say motherhood is sacred, meaning this is our greatest hope for avoiding annihilation. So if we just look at it at that level, you have culture, the world, that's how they see it, that motherhood is absolutely sacred. Babies, motherhood, you can't look there. You can look everywhere else, but not there. Of course, and that's exactly where you need to look. Because we have to see, does that really fixate our mind? The answer is no, absolutely not. And we've already seen that the belief that we'll be annihilated only comes is a misperception, misrepresentation of our refusal to admit we tried to change reality instead of saying that we tried to save reality. See, this is we've been working on this for quite some time. And the question is, did we try to change reality, or are we trying to save reality by hallucinating? We're most definitely hallucinating, which is seeing reality not as it really is. Well, we claim that. Anyway, are we trying to change reality, or are we trying to save reality? If we're trying to change reality, we hallucinated the absence of reality, okay, as the means to try and change reality. And so giving up hallucination means that reality would still be there in its perfect fullness. Everything is the heart of everything, or all in all. All is in all, meaning everything is the heart of everything. Absolute freedom. Instantaneous, intrinsic freedom. So we would not be in any abyss or annihilated at all. But if we claim that we were trying to save reality by hallucinating a new reality, then imagining a new reality, then we try to stabilize that original hallucination, hallucinating the absence of reality. We say, well, that's the new reality, that's the prime creator of the new reality, and then we have to try and stabilize that, because actually it's a hallucination, and which isn't stable. So we're trying to stabilize it by fixating our mind, so that the mind can't stop hallucinating. Very simple. And we do that by being committed to finding a way to fixate the mind, which is why we believe there's something external to our mind that has the power to fixate the mind. And what we're doing is we're playing a very, very intense game or effort of the mind is holding its attention in all these patterns. Okay, it's creatively holding its attention in many a very complex tapestry of play that makes it easy for us to imagine to say that it's fixated, because it seems to keep doing the same stuff, right? But it's doing the same stuff, which is free to do. But it's holding its attention in these patterns, which we call nature, which we call the universe. It's holding its attention there. It's not fixated. And so we just go over this information like this without, again, trying to structure any response to it. All right? So keep that in mind. We're not trying to structure any response to what's being said. Except, wow, we already know what our response and the structure of it is, which is simply, wow, that's it. So that we're able to do this. We're not too nervous. So the wow practice is the heart of success here, actually. Without that, we would become too unhinged by all this, really. Like, how do I respond to this? I don't know how to respond to this. But we know how exactly what our response is. It's wow. So no worries. I'm not bothered. Wow. Of course, it's intense and it gets us nervous, but it doesn't go into panic. You see, it doesn't go into panic. And so in order to really look at these key areas, you cannot panic. You cannot go into panic. If you're prone to panic, you won't even get close to these areas. You get even near and you start screaming fire or shooter, like that. Ah, shooter, shooter. Everyone leave. Because panic. So the path that we've taken is all based on full stop and the wow. It's all based on that. So without that, I can't see how anyone can get there. And throughout history, variations on this have been used to succeed. You have to be able to block panic one way or the other. Okay. Have to be able to do that. We have this extremely effective way to do it. So there's no reason for us to try and innovate around this. I know this is extremely effective. So if you have an extremely effective, fast, agile horse, there's no reason to go about trying to change horses in the middle of the stream. You have what already works. Why fool around with it? Don't try to reinvent the wheel. Okay, so many people try to reinvent the wheel in terms of you have what works, and they say, well, wait a minute, and they spend a lifetime trying to reinvent it. What I did, I didn't reinvent it, I rediscovered it. But the Holy Spirit reintroduced it because it's been used throughout history very effectively. But in our modern age, we tended to have forgotten it. We forgot it. And so I was able to refocus upon this technique, full stop in the wow. Is intentionally choose a structure for all responses, how you're going to respond to whatever clarity arises. This is how you're going to respond. You already know. And it's like a miracle. It's a miracle approach, really, because it works wonders. It just stops panic dead in its tracks. You don't have to think at all. Your thoughts don't even get started. You're thinking about how do I structure my reaction to this. It's just, this extreme, oh my gosh, I've got elation and trepidation arising so strongly. And if we start thinking, I have no idea how to structure this. What do I structure? How will I function? What do I do? Panic ensues. But here we say, I know exactly how to structure. I've already committed to this. I'm committed to structuring it simply as wow. And that's it. Case closed. My structured response to this is wow. My structured overall response is wow. And time and time again, I've used this for so long now. I've been able to really, really get used to it and experience it. And when I don't do it, I go into panic. And it may last a while, maybe a day or two. Sometimes I struggle. And then suddenly I remember to use the wow. And right away, I take suddenly a huge breath of a breath of relief happens. I sigh and I suddenly, immediately start calming down. Immediately start calming down. And I can suddenly feel the tide turn just like that, away from panic. It works every time I really remember to do it. And so it, commitment to it is what counts. It's not wow and something else. Because that then what's something else, and how do you compound them, and how they relate to one another, and there goes the panic. It's a singular response is the key. Just a singular structure and nothing else. Just wow, that's it. It's like the key that opens all locks, so to speak, really. You don't get locked in a room and start panicking. You have the key. You have the key. You open the door, say, "Oh, fresh air, I'm fine. Everything's fine. I'm not locked. I'm not locked in." Wow. You don't have to bounce off the walls inside, desperately searching for a doorway, panicking. Where is it? Is it here? 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 No. Open door. Open door. Everything's fine. Wow. So for me, there cannot be a teaching without this wow practice. For me. Very few are willing to do it for some reason. I don't know. It because they don't seem smart is the problem, right? They say, "Well, I surely I can structure a response better than that." The entire key is to pre-structure your response, and it be a singular response, and it be extremely abstract, but it also relates to the feelings of elation and trepidation. And wow does it perfectly. Wow fits all the those parameters perfectly. Fits them perfectly. So why reinvent the wheel, you see? Say, "Well, I'm so smart. I should be able to, come up with something better. I should be able to reinvent the wheel." No, this works 100%. So why reinvent the wheel? That's you're trying to be too smart. It's too smart. And smartness is really the belief that we can fixate the mind. But if you suffer bad enough, you won't really care about being how smart you are, actually. You only will care about what works. So in the afterlife, the suffering is it's a little different than here in some ways. So you can keep on playing that you're smart and that you can find a way, you think. But here the suffering tends to catch up with you quicker, you see. It has more of a bite to it. So we become more pragmatic here and say, "You know what? I just care about what works. Forget about being smart." But that's why people don't use it. They want to prove how smart they are, saying, I can do better than that. I can come up with a more sophisticated response to that. I should be able to structure a response." But when you get into this very intense recognitions, it's all about blocking panic quickly and effectively. That's all that counts. And you have to have a preconceived structure before you even start your practice, because you know you're going to get tremendous success right away, like we have in this video here. Wow. Immediately you have to use that wow. You have to know exactly that you can use the wow and how to use it and be committed to it and know you can just stay with it. Otherwise, your mind is going to, scream shooter and flee the building. For sure. For sure. Little bit of a smoothie, very thick because I use strawberries it tended to gel the whole thing up. Amazing. Lost a little bit of weight. It's very slow. I'm really surprised I haven't lost more. That's me, you know. It's tough. Starvation. Again, this time 18 hours between eating. I went 18 hours without eating. Yesterday, 17 hours without eating. That should, you know, it will work. Eventually, suddenly, I'll drop like a pound or so, which is great. Then I'll be pretty much in the slot that I want to be in. And we use chit-chat here. And once we accept the wow, and we've really, really accepted just the wow as my response to this, then we can use a little chit-chat, right, to just kind of cool down a little bit. Because what we've looked at here is extremely intense. It's the area we're told never to look at. There's a lot of areas we're told never to look at. In fact, the ego says, don't look at any of this. Just be smarter. You know, the ego says, you've come into this world to be smart, and we just want you to be smarter. Smarter and smarter. Except we get dumb and dumber. Dumb, dumber and dumber is what happens here. As we try to be smart, smarter and smarter. That's what happens. The ego said, don't look at anything we've done here. Everything is going great. We're really making progress to fixating the mind. And you're here to help us out in this great crusade. And we're going to train you to be really smart and then smarter and then smarter. And everything's coming up roses. Look at the great progress we've made to fixating the mind. You know, we're almost there. We're almost there. In fact, we're ready to move into a new age where we'll succeed. You know, this is, success is assured, actually. Or we've been almost smart enough, and we're going to be smart enough, so we'll be able to move in a new age where we succeeded, and then we'll be able to experience the great fruits and benefits of our success in fixating the mind. So, boy, are you fortunate. And there's no reason to look at anything here, because it's successful. You know, just take it like it's successful, and that'll help you out a lot. That's what you get when you come here in the world. Oh, yeah, we've already succeeded. Pretty much so. Well, where is it? Well, we have to wait, you know, on God and the cycles. There'll be a new age here where all the fruits will appear. You know, we've succeeded, but the fruits haven't quite appeared yet because we have to wait for this cosmic clock to somehow align properly, and then all the fruits will be here automatically. Oh, I'm still waiting. Well, it's coming. Oh, you said 2012. Well, you know, it's on its way, you know. The clock just hasn't quite aligned yet, but it'll suddenly align, and we'll all be transformed into this wonderful happiness. The fruits of fixation will be present. All a scam, you know, all an egoic scam. That's all you hear here. Be smarter. Don't look at anything. Don't look within. Don't question at all. Don't question what's going on at all. Just be smarter. Go to school. Get your education. More education. More education. We'll teach you how to be really smart. That's all that education is teaching you to be smarter. Smart, smarter, and smarter-er. And then scream, shooter, when anybody looks within. You know? What a great training, huh? Yeah. Meet the new age, same as the old age, actually. Of course, everyone claims, but we're so smart now that for sure, fixation is basically guaranteed. You know, the new age, there's no doubt about it. Artificial intelligence running the show, and for sure, there's no way that fixation can be ultimately avoided at all. It has to happen. That's the confidence of the new age. It has to happen. There's no way around it. It's just a matter of crunching enough numbers. And that'll do it. And then they wait, you know, wait. Well, the waiting game. And then that gets out of hand, doesn't it? Because it doesn't happen. The waiting game, and how that plays out in very weird ways, to say the least. People get really, really weird. To try and convince themselves, I am fixated, you know, definitely fixated. I'm just not feeling it quite yet. My mind still, something still feels free, you know. So, gotta try and clamp down on that as we wait for the inevitable to happen. The inevitable fixation to happen, which will never happen. So, waiting for Godot, you know, it'll never happen. Waiting for fixation to happen, it'll never happen. So it's the long wait is a quite a terrible wait, isn't it? Quite a terrible weight upon our mind, our shoulders. It's like, wow, what's going on? So this world keeps telling you, you got to wait for it. You got to wait. And I tried to say, no. And they said, what are you talking about? It's guaranteed. You know, you're crazy. For sure it's going to work. Well, look how smart we are. We're in the scientific age now. We can't fail. Look at this, aluminum. Look what we're doing. We're fixating everything. And we'll eventually we'll figure out how to fixate the mind too. Like, look at all these products, these fixations we're producing. You know, we're so smart now that for sure we'll figure out how to fixate the mind. We got the halide collider, you know, whatever you call it, you know, and we're making black holes and all this stuff, and oh, you know, fixation of the mind is guaranteed. You just gotta hang in there. I said, wow. No, it's not going to work. Well, I said, shut up, you know. No, nobody wants to hear that. You're a Debbie Downer, you know. Nobody wants to hear what you have to say. A Cassandra, you know. So you become isolated here. When you say it won't work, nobody wants to hear that. Almost no one. But, right. By and large, right, culture, society doesn't want to hear that. They're like, you know, look at what we're doing. Look at the buildings. Look at everything we're making. Look at all the fixation we're producing. Are you kidding me? And we even got pharmaceuticals that'll make you think everything's fixated. I'll make you happy as you wait. Don't worry about the long wait. We'll make you happy as you wait. Yep, that's good old culture. World culture. Gotta love it. Or not. But we're able to look at this because we have the wow. Well, we have structure. Yeah, we do have one temporary fixation, you might call it, which is really just, we're imagining this as a temporary fixation just to honor our creativity. But we realize ultimately, you know, well, even that will be seen as it's not a fixation. But it's a tool, pragmatic tool we're using to help us back away from everything else and stabilize our path as we work towards recognition. As Jesus likes to say, it's the illusion that removes all other illusions. And ultimately, once it's done that perfectly, it itself is not necessary anymore. But we're in no hurry to drop the wow. We're in no hurry to drop the wow. As long as we want to function in this world, we probably will need the wow. Pass it on, too. Pass on the wow. It's all about the wow, which again transcends smartness into pure pragmatism. So there's two types in the world. Those who are trying to be smart and those who are decided to be pragmatic. And those two go in very different directions. John Carpenter, Tom Carpenter didn't ask, Tom and Linda Carpenter didn't ask Jesus. Jesus says, well, in the afterlife is more difficult. I would say, Jesus, is it possible that there's some other scenario where we're not in this world, where we leave this world, but we're not in the afterlife? Isn't that some other possible scenario that you wouldn't consider an afterlife situation? But it's just not this world? Yeah. Why not? A reduced intensity zone? Where we experience that fixation, a much diminished external world, so that it seems much less fixated than this one does. This one gives us so much quote-unquote evidence, sensory perception evidence of fixation and producing massive amounts continuously, pumping out the concrete and steel, all right? And materiality, which is, of course, none of that is actually fixated either. But to the senses, to sensory perception, it certainly seems fixated, doesn't it? So we have this false witnessing called sensory perception, which isn't able to see the spaciousness of everything, the non-fixated quality of everything. That everything is still the heart of everything. And that it's just, or we're holding our attention there. We're not, sensory perception is not able to see that. So so the body is a false witness. Sensory perception gives a false witness, which tends to believe, which gives us belief in fixation, external fixation. And then we try to then extend that to fixating the mind. We say, well, we've been able to fixate all of this stuff here. You know, why can't we fixate the mind? So we believe that nature can fixate our mind. We believe that nature is able to fixate our mind. So why can't we go to another world where nature doesn't seem to be that way? Where nature is more interactive, you know. Certainly, I believe that's possible. Where there's more of a flow. When we ask something to flow, it flows, so to speak. Things don't seem as quite as set. Reduced intensity of this delusion of fixation, and that would be an intermediate step. Ultimately, seeing the intrinsic spaciousness of everything. Very, very clearly, which is called guru vision. It's not sensory perception. That then dispels the spell of fixation. It's all just decoration. It's intrinsic spaciousness decorating itself. Okay, with attention decorating its intrinsic spaciousness by patterns of holding the attention moment by moment by moment. Like that, but it's seen that there's no fixation taking place at all of our attention. Very clearly seen, but that sensory perception will never show us that. Wow, can I get a wow about all this? Absolutely. Historically, a variation on the wow is to just pay attention to your breath. So there are those who did that, and that probably would work as well. It has a slight. I've never felt comfortable doing that, but some feel comfortable doing that historically. So you either have this structure of a wow, or you just pay attention to your breath. Wow is a little more abstract, I would say. It's for those who have a certain type of focus, and then the breath, watching your breath is for those who have a slightly different makeup in terms of their uniqueness. But that would probably work too. But that's a different. You know, I've never even tried it. Every time I try it, I say no. That's not for me. Wow, first for me. Wow. So I never pay attention to my breath. Basically, no. In fact, I ignore it. I try to ignore the body. So I'm more into just the mind. Just wow. It's a mental, it's a mind, like wow, my mind is just, and it's not really coming from the body, whereas paying attention to the breath, you're paying attention to the body. But for some who are maybe more oriented in a certain way, that might work. And historically, I think it can be shown that does work. But then you get into all this breath control and doing all this stuff. And so then you see it can lend itself to too many ramifications. It should only be used just, anyway, I'll let those who teach that way, they have to deal with that. We don't teach that way. So we just teach just the wow. We don't worry about our breath, what our body's doing or anything. We just sit quietly, committed to doing nothing at all. And when you block panic with the mind this way, you know, the body's fine. The body will keep breathing of its own. You don't have to worry about that. So there are variants on this. The bottom line in all of it is to block panic. That's the bottom line. In all successful practice throughout history, blocking panic is a common variable. And there might be, you know, there's different size wheels. You know, there's the one with the high pressure tires now. They're narrow, normal pressure, and then the bigger four wheel drive kind of chunky off-terrain wheels. So there's different types of wheels, but they're still wheels. We're not reinventing the wheel, actually. Okay, we're not reinventing the wheel. But some people, you know, have different vehicles. They use different tires on them. And we're not trying to integrate, because that's trying to be too smart. We're just using what works, which is wow, most certainly works extremely well for the approach that we're using. The new way is wow. The new way is wow. The new way is wow. So we're already into the new way. We're not waiting for some success. We already have it. And that's the new way of practicing. The new way is wow. We devalue the I. I can never find peace at all. Jesus in Dialogue on Awakening says, I want you to focus on only doing what brings you peace. Only do what brings you peace. So I was focusing on this. I said, what brings me peace? And I realized nothing at all brings me peace. I've never had peace in this world at all. And so and then I started to realize, but what brings me peace is to devalue the I, is to say, I can never find peace in any way. I can never find peace. And right away, I feel the burden is off my shoulders to try and find peace. You see, I can never find peace. It's trying to find it that disturbs it. Or that doesn't disturb it. It pretends it's not there. Already there. It's already there. I don't need to do anything to be peaceful. So it's the belief we have to do something to find peace, that's the problem in the first place. That's really an attempt to fixate the mind. So I kind of flipped the script here, and I said, okay, what do I do to find peace? I say, I can never find peace. I can never find peace in any way. And then right away I feel, oh, that, you know, that's leading me, that's helping me drop my pretension that I'm not already peaceful. That I'm not already experiencing peace. And to say, I need do nothing to experience peace, I'm already experiencing it perfectly. That also would be it. Wow. Because really, can we think, has anything, I can't think of a single moment in my life trying to do anything where I've experienced peace. Never. So how can I possibly do only what brings me peace, you know? It's in the not doing anything at all. Not believing that I don't need to do anything at all to be peaceful. That's where peace is. So really, it's I can't do anything where I'm not peaceful, is the truth. There's no way I can not be peaceful. So making these assertions, it for me, is the best. That's where I feel most peaceful, is making these assertions, even though it jangles my nerves. But it's because of my expectations that my nerves are getting jangled. I can sense the peace that's there. If my nerves weren't jangled, it would be there. But I understand that there's no way we can do anything in this world and find peace because of our expectations. So, and we keep thinking, oh, that doesn't work, because our expectations are such. You know, we think we have to search and find and do something to experience peace, when in fact, we need to give up the search. We need to give up trying to do anything. But that jangles our expectations, like, oh, well, we'll be annihilated then. We'll fall into an abyss. Reality doesn't exist anymore. Only this hallucination is a new reality. And we have to separate it from the mind, so it's not subject to the mind changing its mind, deciding in another instant, deciding not to hallucinate. We have to separate it from the mind and make it the new prime creator, and it then is the one that creates the mind that we have. And we have to have this mind that is fixated. So it's a new creation of fixation, and we have to find peace within that. You know, that's impossible, right? It's impossible. I'm going to shake up the smoothie and make it flow a little better. All right. That worked. That worked. It flows better. For me, trying to do something to be peaceful is completely futile. There's nothing I need to do to be peaceful. There's nothing I can do to be peaceful. There's nothing I can do to be liberated. There's nothing I can do to be peaceful. There's nothing I can do to be awake. I'm already awake. I'm already liberated. I'm already peaceful. Not even liberated. There's nothing to be liberated from. You could say liberated from the ceaseless, you know, the rounds of transmigration, of attempting to be liberated. I'm liberated from the delusion that I need to be liberated from something. You could say that. So this is a new way. We have the new way. So rejoice in that. We have the new way already. We beat the new age to the punch. The new age is really the age of artificial intelligence. It was a trap. I knew it was a trap. They tried to seduce us into it, you know, and saying it's liberation. It's liberating everybody. All those who are oppressed, you know, it's liberating them. Into what? Into striving for liberation? Yeah. Which is the whole problem in the first place. It's like trying to wake up is the whole problem. We're already awake. So the new age, meet the new age, same as the old age. We got fooled again, to transpose the Who's lyrics. We did get fooled again. Well, we didn't, but most in the world have gotten fooled again. No teacher, no teaching, no student. Meaning, drop the notion of waking up. It's that automatically has the supposition, the supposition, right? The premise that we got fixated. And we're saying like, oh, fixation's a bad thing? Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, here, let me undo fixation. Since I did fixation, I know how to undo it, right? Yeah, we can get science working on that, and we'll figure out how do we unfixate the mind. That's delusion. That's the wheel of delusion right there. How do we unfixate the mind is delusion, is the wheel of transmigration, the vast disc of transmigrating through all of these different, you know, scenarios that, like, compulsively, right, they're driven. I got to be smarter. I got to figure out, how do I unfixate? How do I get liberated? How do I wake up? You know, that's the delusion. It's how do we manage our nerves and expectations so that we're able to accept that we never had a need to wake up. We never want to sleep. We were never not awake in the first place. We were never fixated. How do we give up the effort to remove fixation? We realize we've never been fixated. That's the real path. And that's what clashes with our expectations. It's easy if you say, well, I'm working to wake up. I'm working on liberation. I'm working to remove fixation. I'm trying to fix, trying to fix the world. That's all our expectations are aligned in that direction. And those are the expectations that drive you around this vast disk of transmigration, compulsively push you through birth, death, birth, death, birth, death, in all these different scenarios. You keep going through these different scenarios. That's the engine that drives you, is our expectations. And you keep thinking you're righteous. We keep thinking we're righteous. We say, I don't understand what's wrong. I don't understand what's wrong. I'm doing everything I'm supposed to do. I'm trying to wake up. I'm seeking liberation. I'm searching for peace. I'm trying to do what makes me peaceful. I'm trying to get the mind, unfixated. I'm really working hard to dissolve all that fixation the mind's been in, and it still doesn't work. Maybe something wrong with God. Maybe God hates me. So all of that is based on the premise that we did lose our peace, that we did fall asleep, that we did fixate the mind. Not being awake means the mind would be fixated. So it's obviously all built on the premise that we already succeeded. Now we're trying to undo our success. So as Jesus says, our entire problem is we're trying to make illusions true. We're claiming illusions are true and then trying to undo them. That's it. But the issue is all our expectations are aligned in that way. So as soon as we go counter to our expectations, that's when the panic jumps up and bites us. And that's the beginning of the path, the real path. The other way is just a compulsive turning of the wheel of transmigration based on our expectations. That's it. The real path is when you go counter to those expectations, and that's when you have to block panic. You have to block it because our expectations are so aligned in such a way that when we run counter to them, immediately the fear of annihilation arises. Like, oh my God, how can I restructure fixation? I got to get back to fixation. I'm not quite sure how to do it. I just lost my focus, But we say, no, I got my focus. It's wow. Yeah, fixate the mind as wow. That's it. No other need to do it. We have the answer. Now, this is just a tool, right? And Jesus says it's fine to use this tool. This is what you're supposed to do, actually. It's sort of an intermediate step. It reshapes our expectations. And then once all our expectations are reshaped in the right direction, then we've done our work. we realize, right? Yeah. I never lost my peace. I never lost my freedom. I never lost anything at all, my functionality. Everything is perfect. It's always been perfect. I never was fixated. I never had any regrets, actually. And it never touched. This dream of fixation never touched me. I was untouched by it, always been untouched by it. I didn't need to do anything to remove anything. Nothing needed to be removed. It's only these expectations that have been troubling me. And the fear of annihilation based on a false, dishonesty, really. And claiming I hallucinated in order to save reality. That's being dishonest. So even when you're honest and say, no, it was try to change reality, the expectations are still there. Okay, and so we have to work with these expectations of what we expect, what we're familiar with. We're so familiar. Our expectations are so ingrained in us that it's, quite a bit of trouble to reshape them. And blocking panic is essential to do this, absolutely essential. Just like for me, a 6-to-6 diet is essential. If I really want to lose some weight, I've been trying for weeks, and it just wasn't working. So, gone back to 6 to 6. That takes some discipline. But once you do it for like 1 day, 2 days, you say, it's not that difficult. You wake up hungry, that's all. You wake up more hungry than normal. Whereas at normal days, like you might wake up not feel any hunger at all, you still stuff your face in the morning. But now I wake up and I really feel hungry. Let me get some food. Yeah. That's the only difference. Wake up hungry, which is it's fine. It's not a problem. When you're asleep, you don't feel your hunger. And it works. 6 to 6 really works. It's a discipline. It works. So I expect to see some more poundage coming off and getting in just that right weight for, yeah, what for what? Hey, the next big thing. Windy today, I'll tell you. Very breezy. Huh. I'm still hungry. I've only had a few sips of a smoothie in the last 19 and a half hours. So, but that's good. It's good to feel hungry. A little hungry. And there can't be any quid pro quo. We have to just rule that out, you know, because this is how I got into trouble. They said, well, we'll do what you ask us to do if you do what we ask you to do. But what they're asking us to do is to rejoin the expectations. And so then you get nowhere, because then you're frantically keeping your expectations the way the world wants it to be, which is really... is a sly way of, it's really stating the basic premise that we did fixate the mind and now we have to unfixate it. So they want you to keep doing that, and they say, we'll work on the expectations, you know, that you told us to do. But the fact is, they don't do it. And even if they did, they'd be blocked, be a zero-sum game, because I'd be strengthening the expectations that they're trying to undo. So really, we just go around in circles that way. So we really, that's just really absurd. No quid pro quo. You know, if you donate to my cause, I'll help your cause. No. If you want to really experience peace, then you have to do it this way. Okay, you have to reshape your expectations and block panic. There's no other way for anyone. So there's nothing I need to do in reciprocation for you doing this. Why should I have to do anything? You're doing what benefits you already. I don't have to benefit you any more than that. I'm offering you what truly benefits you. So that is charity and welfare right there. It's the highest charity and welfare. I don't need to do any other. That would take away what they really says. Stop speaking truth and I'll follow. I don't need you to speak that. I can do it on my own. But we don't want anyone speaking the truth here. But we'll do it on our own. It's just a stupid, it's absurdist kind of. But everyone thinks they're so smart, they can pass off absurdity somehow. They just want to figure out how do we do it. And so they make you look like you're the bad person. You know, you didn't donate, you didn't help here, you didn't do this, you didn't do this. And I said, well, okay, I'll do that. But you practice like this. Does anyone practice like this? No. They just forget about it in 2 seconds. Oh yeah, I forgot about that. What they really hope is that you'll forget about it. So they may pretend to do it for a little while, just waiting for you to lose your way, and then they'll quit, and you won't know about it. You'll think, oh, they're fine. You know, that's what their aim is at. So anyone who asks for a quid pro quo to do the spiritual path is only interested in you leaving the path. I say no deals. How can we make deals around this issue that we can't fixate the mind? What deal is there to make? We have the one deal and that's it. Wow. Any more deal than just a singular deal is inviting panic on the path. Invites panic right in. Must have a singular deal and stick to it, and that is it. And we already have the deal, folks. So when someone offers me another deal, says, hey, why don't you do this and that? I say, we already have the one deal. It has to be a singular deal, and we already have it, so why don't you accept the one deal? That's the best deal. Don't offer me some other deal. Singularity like this blocks the panic from arising. If you, as soon as you go to, then there's the battle of which one is more, which proportion is more. You start thinking about it. Well, is it this one? Should I emphasize this or this? Or should I keep exactly the same? But how do I keep exactly the same emphasis? Because sometimes I think maybe this one might be better and this other one might. And before you know it, boom, the thinking just expands into panic, doesn't it? Mental panic. And of course, most people think that mental panic is normal. Well, it's normal for them because they're always in the panicked mode. Most of us in this world are constantly in a mode of panic, mental panic. So they think, well, I'm just getting back to normal. What's normal? What I'm used to. Well, we are battling against what we're used to, what our expectations expect here. So we have to block going back into panic. Otherwise, we won't have the clarity to make progress. We'll stall out right away. Right away. And we'll just substitute labels, you know. We'll just talk a good game. You know, there's some that stall out. I've stalled out who can talk a good game, covering up the fact they stalled out. That's just more smartness, right? What it means is that they don't have the wow. They don't have the singular way to block panic. They don't know how to do it. Or they think they're too smart. They don't need it. And they're into panic again. They panicked again. And trying to be smart, saying, no, my smartness can handle panic. No, smartness is panic, actually. Smartness is panic. It's a posing. It's a way of posing in panic. It's a way that panic presents itself to proclaim that it's really success. Like this panic is being very successful in fixating the mind. So it's very smart. So, you know, the traditional religions, what they've done is they've had the time to structure an approach. And like Tibetan Buddhism, they call it something, I don't know how they pronounce it. There's the basic practice you got to go through is the preliminaries. I don't know how to say it, Ngondro or something. And you don't get the more advanced teachings our way until you have shown that you're very proficient in all the basics. And really, for us, the basics is this wow practice. You cannot go into these higher kind of considerations here without being an expert, really, at blocking panic. And you become that as you go along, as you practice more and more and more, and as more you do it, the more expert you become at it. But, you know, you're never expert enough. I mean, I still flounder at times, absolutely. I try not to, but the intensity of this is such that you do occasionally flounder, but then you catch yourself. You right the ship. You know, it's like in a stormy sea, you better have a ship that's very seaworthy. So the ship will flounder about for it, but it doesn't sink here. My ship doesn't sink. It's very resistant to sinking. But that's not to say that it doesn't flounder and we don't take on water and the waves are crashing all over us. Yeah, absolutely, at times it does. We try to keep the water calm. Sometimes it gets a little stormy. So without first going through the preliminary, maybe it takes they're born into it. They're around people that use it all the time. They know how to calm them, block panic. So for them, it's like a cultural thing. They grow up being taught how to block panic. And then they have to make sure that they're, you know, very, very committed to it and recognize that this is it. This is how we do it. And They may be different ways, slightly different ways, different schools of blocking panic, but they all respect one another. We realize we're doing the same thing. We're working on expectations. We're blocking panic. We're using a singularity to do it, okay? Singularity to do it. And we're not trying to reinvent the wheel, so if you pay attention to your breath, that's fine. If I use the wow, that's fine. We're not going to clash over that at all. And we'll honor and respect a pass, and the success that we have will reinforce one another. You know, it's like that. So they all realize that we're going in this, pulling in the same direction here. But it's really important to have a singularity. You see, we can't, that is not something that you can reinvent and say, no, it has to really be a singularity. And the simple the singularity, the better, which is why I like wow. It's primally simple, isn't it? Primarily simple. With the breath, there's all sorts of different, it can get very complex. With the wow, there's no complexity to it at all. There's no complexity. It's primarily simple. No singularity to it. Because it's so abstract. You know, you can't really break it down into any component parts at all. And it's not aligned with any process like breath. Breath is a process. We want to get free of any notion of process at all. Totally free of that. It's just simply wow. And again, how do we define wow? But wow is how we define wow. So we do not negotiate any of this. It's non-negotiable. Okay. Negotiation immediately gets away from the commitment to a singularity. And or trying to reinvent the wheel. Okay. We already have something that's extremely abstract, no process involved, perfect singularity, ideal singularity. Trying to reinvent the wheel is then you're just wasting time, okay? We're just catering to smartness, which is just stalling out, actually. And you don't want to stall out in the path. So that's another thing. You do not want to stall out. So people might think that we're closed-minded. Well, so we have to be closed-minded to anything other than a singularity and closed-minded to stall outs. Otherwise, we'll fail. So we're very closed-minded to failure, absolutely. You have to be. So there's a huge division between the secular culture and Dharmic culture. Is Dharmic culture is closed-minded to failure. Absolutely, they are. Have to be. Otherwise, you're not Dharmic. You're secular. You're still trying to reinvent the wheel, trying to figure a way to fix what was never broken in the first place. So you're still trying to be greater than God, actually, and caught up in smartness. So yeah, there's a fundamental divide between secular and Dharmic culture. Fundamental divide. Dharmic culture, again, is absolutely closed-minded to failure. Okay, and so they're closed-minded to anything other than a singularity, and they're closed-minded to anything, to all stall-outs, all stall-outs. Closed-minded to stalling out. Closed-minded to any deal-making, any negotiating, all of that. Have to be. And of course, the secular culture says that's not fair. Meaning, that doesn't help us. Well, you can't help anyone do the impossible. And so they say, well, God, your God isn't helping us. Well, God can't help us do the impossible. And so we're closed mind to failure. Absolutely, we're closed-minded to failure, and we're absolutely closed-minded to anything other than success. Failing to succeed, we're closed-minded to that. And what is really success? Recognizing that failure is impossible for us, that we've never failed, we've never been fixated, we can't do the impossible. So secular culture will always try to negotiate something, negotiate us away from singularity into complexity. And we say, no negotiations. And they say, well, that's unfair. They'll always claim unfairness, that singularity is somehow unfair. I say, well, you should at least discuss it. We're closed. That causes a stall out. So we're close to stalling out. And they say, well, you shouldn't stall because if you're smart enough. And again, it's the smartness that stalls us out. So we're closed-minded towards smartness. Absolutely, you have to be. Smartness causes stall out because it thinks it can negotiate the essential tools that we need to not stall out. As soon as you start negotiating, you're going to go right into panic. And that stalls you out right away. So they simply do not understand the issue of their expectations at all. They're ignorant, you might say. It's ignorant society. Secular culture is ignorant culture. Compulsively driven culture, posing as if they're so smart that they're bound to succeed, even though they're trying to do the impossible, trying to make illusions true and then undo those true illusions. So there's no way to integrate secular culture and dharmic culture. It's impossible. You cannot integrate it. That's negotiate. What it really means is negotiation. And that stalls out dharmic culture, which is why dharmic culture has been stalled out, is this push of secular culture into artificial intelligence. Is they think they're so confident now, they think, you know what, we really have the basis now to insist on negotiation, because we really, you see, we've advanced so much in our smartness that there's just no way you cannot negotiate at this point, you know. That they've got this high and mighty attitude right now, secular culture, and they can't, and anyone who now doesn't agree to negotiate, they feel, well, you're just, you know, absolutely horrible person. And the smart folks are the ones who always want to negotiate. They're obsessed with negotiating because it takes them away from singularity. And of course, singularity threatens them, their expectations. It threatens their panic, which is really what's driving the engine of transmigration, is panic. Threatens it. They feel very threatened by it. And they want their cake and eat it too. They know that going into forth with artificial intelligence, they're scared, really scared. So they say, well, we want to take some little bit of help along, but we don't want a singularity help. You know, it's got to be dualistic. It's got to. We still got to have the panic. Our expectations still have to be met. We've got to be. Got to stay in panic, but we want some comfort as we go into artificial intelligence because we think it's really going to be terrible. Yeah. Hey, we got to be honest and say there's no way you can do that. So you got to face the terribleness of it and decide, is that what you really want? Well, the suffering will most certainly, they're kind of saying, we need artificial intelligence, but we don't want it to be so terrible that we suffer so terribly that we decide to, you know, start blocking panic and going against our expectations, because that'll really be difficult. So is there some way we can have our cake and eat it too? Can we have all this artificial intelligence culture and all this, but feel comfortable with it, and can we be comfortable with our panic? Can you help us? I mean, if you were aligned with God, you'd surely find some way to help us. No, God cannot help us do the impossible. So most definitely the secular culture is going to suffer terribly, which is great, because it's getting to that point of desperation when you finally realize you have no choice. You have no choice but to start going counter to your expectations. And then that throws up panic, most certainly does. And then you got to start figuring out, how do I block this panic? And it took me decades and decades of working on this before I really started to be able to do it effectively. I mean, it must have taken me like 3 decades or so, at least. Probably like 3 decades of working on, of struggling and not knowing how to block the panic. And it's only in the past decade or so that I've really been able to really start really dial it in and realize, oh, there is this technique. Because before I didn't have it. So I just suffered terribly. So not having this technique will cause massive suffering in the future when you just realize that artificial intelligence, you just can't stay with it. You just can't. And then you got to go contrary to your expectations. Secular culture will realize that. And then they'll just be floundering, you know, and suffering so bad. Need medication. It's horrible. Wow. And then they'll need help from teachers who know how to do this, for sure. So I can't let them sink me, because they'll need me down the road to help out. They can't sink this awareness. That'll be disastrous for them down the road. You know, they need all the help they can get. Once they're suffering, they realize they have to start going counter to their expectations. And when you start doing that, it's very scary. Very, very scary. You think you're going to be annihilated. It's like if I stop panicking, I'm going to be annihilated. That's what we tell ourselves. So we most certainly have to stick with this, to be compassionate to all, taking a long approach, knowing that they will sing a different tune quite soon than they're singing now. You know, the smartness, they'll realize, wow, this is just actually a nightmare. Terrible nightmare. And they'll say, let's all nightmare together. You know, that'll do it. And that won't do it either. And they'll try this and try that. Smartness keeps telling you. Smartness will always give you something to try. Something other than singularity. Something other than blocking panic. It will always give you options. But if you try enough of them, you realize none of them work. And you know this is just another lie. So why don't you try this? You know, so now, I know that won't work. There's no way. There's no way. And then you become open to the Holy Spirit and say, hey, you know, okay, let's work towards using this, blocking the panic. And you might say, oh, I don't know, that seems pretty risky. You know, I might go too fast if I do that. Don't think the fortunate ones are the ones that die. It's not true. The fortunate ones are ones that are still here learning how to block panic, actually doing it. Going contrary to our expectations, reshaping the expectations and so doing, blocking the panic. They're the fortunate ones. Don't take refuge in death. That was the key moment for me when I realized my previous lives, and I realized that taking a refuge in death never worked. It has never worked. Every time I thought it would work, it never worked. You find yourself getting a return ticket. So I realized you can never use death as the remedy. I ruled it out. That was the first step I took. I ruled it out entirely. I said, it's off, non-negotiable. That's off the plate. That's non-negotiable. So Dharma culture has these areas that are totally non-negotiable. And secular culture is the culture that insists that everything is negotiable. Okay, and so, you know, that's like saying that reality is negotiable. It's not. So to be part of Dharma culture, you have to accept there's these certain areas that are simply non-negotiable, and you don't keep trying to negotiate them. Now, there are some smart Alex in secular culture that want to undermine Dharmic culture, who pretend to be big shot gurus and stuff, just to show, and then just to fail, to show everyone, oh, you see, you know, that doesn't work. Just recognize that. Is they abuse the whole thing. They set up, oh, this is non-negotiable, this, you got to do it, this, and they end up, you know, being these monsters, and then it turns everybody off. Oh, then secular culture goes, oh, Dharma culture is so terrible, you know. But those are false cases that secularists are actually presenting, these false cases to try and demonize Dharma culture, to make them seem, you know, mean and unfair and all this kind of stuff. You get these, you know, of course secular culture does that. They're very smart tricky and smart. So this, you know, false rotten egg, you know, rotten apple, intentionally knowing they're going to be rotten, and trying to make sure everyone sees how rotten they are, to try to then to taint all the other apples, you know, that are doing it the right way. So just be aware that that is always taking place. Secular culture always is trying to use these boogeymen to scare everybody away from Dharmic culture. So we're just setting the record straight. There are these areas that are non-negotiable, absolutely, for our benefit, for our success. There's no negotiating these issues. And again, the secular mindset always is trying to negotiate them. It just tries to find what tactic can I use to negotiate this. And what it's really saying is, it wants to negotiate with God, the issue of reality. It wants to say, God, we want you to accept that we did fixate the mind, and in exchange, we'll unfixate it. It's kind of like holding God hostage, isn't it? Yeah. It's like, we kidnap the mind, God, and we'll return it to you, but for a price. So you have to admit that we're capable of changing reality. See, you got to admit we did change it. We'll change it only, and only us know how to change it back. See, you don't know how to do it because you don't know how to change it, God. But we do. We figured it out. We're smarter than you. But so we'll change it back as long as you recognize we're smarter than you. That's really what secular culture is all about. Wow, huh? Wow, to see that, yeah. So we want to retain the upper hand. We're offering God, what a deal we have for you, God. We'll make reality, we'll let it go back the way that it used to be, okay? So that'll make you happy. But we just, in return, you have to understand that we're greater than you. Because we know if you step out of line, don't do what we tell you to do, we'll change it again. So you have to admit that we're greater than you, you see, and worship us. That's what secular culture is all about. You know, they're all fighting over, well, what figurehead do we want to use for secular culture? You know, this one looks pretty good. And someone else says, now how about this one? As they're all fighting over, you know, which figurehead do we use for this preposterousness, you know? And they expect us to somehow be interested in that. You know, which figurehead do we use to promote this lie? Bamboozle God, so to speak. What negotiator? How can we bamboozle God? What figurehead do we need? So some groups promoting this one. Said, this one is ideally suited to negotiate with God. And then someone else says, no, this one's trickier. He's smoother, you know, or she is smoother. Or basically they go, the gender thing. Well, the men haven't been able to, they're not sly enough to bamboozle God. You gotta present a real sweet, kind, compassionate face to God and say, God, don't worry, we'll be really compassionate to you. Once we restore reality to the way you wanted it and realize that we can change it at a whim whenever we want to. But if you're really nice to us, we won't do it. So we want to show you that we're really lovable and nice and kind, like a nice mother, you're like a child and you love your mother, and that'll work for you, you see. So, you know, secular culture tries that. They try the men figureheads, and then they say, wait a minute, let's try the female figureheads. I think maybe God will like that better. God's maybe too threatened by a male figurehead, so let's have a mother figurehead. And God will say, oh, okay, mother. Yeah, I think I can stay on your good side. You seem like a nice, compassionate being, so I know how to stay on your good side, so you won't change reality on me again. Okay, I hope not. But I kind of live in fear, you know, that you might, you know, because, you know, sometimes mother is not so happy with what their child does. They may not be happy with reality the way it actually is. We know how the mother can suddenly turn and become this monster, right? That the niceness is a facade. If you do what mother wants you to do, that's great, but she always wants you to do more. It's never enough, right? And at some point, we get the daggers. And she'll let you know, mother will let you know, hey, if you don't do what I tell you to do, I'm going to change reality. I'm going to go back and change reality on you. You won't even have any access to me at all. I'll cut you off, God, just like that. But you don't want that. And I'm not asking too much of you, God. My requests are nice and sweet, compassionate for you. I just want what's best for you, God. So I'm sure that, you understand that and will be able to comply with what I tell you to do. That's mother. The mother figurehead that secular culture is promoting these days. So it's very important to not get fooled by that as if the game has changed. The game has not changed in the slightest bit. Secular culture never changes the game. Never changes the game. And the notion that we have a trickier way to negotiate with God, we got to rule that out, and Dharmic culture rules it out. They rule it out. Not negotiable. And to use the male figurehead is better. Why? Because the male figurehead is obviously less effective in our minds than the mother archetype. So we want to stay away from being tempted towards the mother archetype, thinking that though that's going to be more effective in negotiating with God. Since we rule out negotiation altogether, we want to choose the lousier of the two negotiators to work on saying no to that. Okay. So we don't want to say no to the male negotiator and then say yeah, but the female negotiator, that might be better. So again, a singularity with that too. Very important to have a singularity with this issue. And we choose, Dharma culture has always chosen the male because we realize there's less, we say, the male, no chance, he's too obvious, God, that won't work, that won't work. And we want to accept no negotiation will work with God. So we certainly want to have the lousier negotiator as our, as the only, and not, as keep that as a singularity. Keep it as a singularity. So that's why we've used the, Dharma culture has used the male. Mother seems much more likely to bamboozle God than father. Okay. And since God can't be bamboozled at all, and we totally expect, our expectations are that God can, the way we proceed is to take the lousier of the two negotiators, which makes us feel like, you know what, I think this whole thing's going to fail, which is what we want to focus on. Of course it has to fail. So we want to accentuate the likelihood that it will never work, rather than trying to accentuate that maybe it can work. If we just get the right mother in there, maybe it'll work. Okay. So, see, secular culture screams sexism, whereas Dharmic culture screams pragmatism. Okay. So they have no, secular culture has no idea what they're talking about in relation to Dharmic culture. They're utterly ignorant of it, and they're doing the opposite, trying to harm it as much as possible by saying, let's just switch figureheads here. No, that just makes it. It just undermines and stalls out the whole situation. Because we know that mother can trump father at any time if she really wants to. So we realize that men are not as strong as mother. So we want the weakest negotiator. When we talk with this issue, we want to look at it and say, you know what? I really, my belief that negotiation will fail is helped by believing that the negotiator has to be a male here, because I really believe that it's going to fail. So we want to believe that it's going to fail. That helps us believe it's going to fail. Whereas you plug a mother in there, we're gonna have an extremely difficult time believing it's going to fail. We're always going to hold out hope for mother. Every one of us holds out. I think that where father fails, I believe that mother can do it. This is a fundamental problem of secular culture. Fundamental problem. Jesus uses the masculine. Not in my mind, use the masculine. You know, it's always he, father, this. Why? Because again, just what we've said, that helps us greatly in realizing, you know, I really believe negotiating with God is a non-starter. It's not going to work. And then that really goes counter to our expectations. Then we have to use the singularity of wow to block the panic. And we're then able to look at this whole, you know, this silliness of the whole situation more and more clearly, more and more clearly. And realizing that, you know, that there's no mother or father at all. How could there be a mother of fixation, and how could there be a father of fixation? There's no fixation. So if you want to lose faith in negotiation, you're going to choose the lousiest negotiator on your side, right? That's just pure pragmatism. Because then you're going to think, you know what? This negotiation is not going to go in my way, my direction. I don't think we can negotiate with God. And again, isn't that what we're trying to do? Secular culture is saying, God, we have changed reality, but we'll change it back for you if you'd agree to our terms that you worship us and realize that we're better than you and we're the real prime creator. That's all. We'll return reality just exactly the way you want it, as long as you recognize us that we're the prime creator and not you. Of course, that's not the way that God wants reality, right? Yeah, and so, you know, it's a silly thing. So we want to be able to see how ridiculous it is. It's totally disingenuous for anyone to claim that they don't believe, that they think mother is the lesser of the two negotiators. No way. That's very disingenuous. In everyone's experience, we know that mother has her ways to get around father. And we can appeal to her better than we can father, and she'll negotiate for us better. And that's the setup that we have come up with, you see. So it's super disingenuous to climb to cry sexism in terms of Dharmic culture. That's only in terms of secular culture. You can cry whatever you want, but we're not part of secular culture here. We're part of Dharmic culture. And we don't allow that disingenuousness here, okay? We do not allow that. And we don't allow any negotiation. It's not negotiable. See, that's another thing. We use the male pronoun. That's not negotiable. Makes it a lot easier, extremely easier. And we need all the easement we can get, actually, because it's already brutally difficult. And if we don't use that male pronoun, it becomes prohibitively difficult, which is what secular culture wants. It wants to bring us to the negotiating table, just like it wants to bring God to the negotiating table. That's its whole point. It says, I got to bring you God to the negotiating table, because we're getting tired of your intransigence, you know. We want to return reality to the way it was, God, but we got to negotiate a settlement with you. And you have to agree that we're the new prime creator, and that everything will be fine. We'll all be happy. We'll all be happy then. And most of secular culture, just their whole thing is they believe they're training to be better negotiators. And so they look like at me and they say, okay, we know your role. Yeah, you don't need to tell us your role. We already know it. You're here to help us be better negotiators, right? Because you say that you want to be happy, you know, salvation, you know, enlightenment. Well, we know what enlightenment is. It's bringing God to the negotiating table, getting God to agree to our demands, restoring reality the way it was, and everything's happy. So you just have to tell us how to better negotiate with God. That's all. We know your role. We know your role. That's what secular culture tries to tell everyone here. That those who are part of Dharmic culture, they're trying to reassign them to secular roles, actually. Hallelujah. Wow. I'm gonna dilute that smoothie with a little bit of water. That's how we make it go farther. So I started out as really thick, very, very thick, and then I diluted it a little bit with water so it keeps going a little bit. Perfect. Took all the water there. Hallelujah. July 2nd. Awesome. July has been extremely good to us already, hasn't it? Extraordinarily great to us. I mean, just consider the progress we've made in the last 2 days. It is just... Wow. I'm just, shake it up. Beautiful. Tastes great. Not too watery. So, yeah, maybe I better take a break. I'm on such a roll that, you know, the progress we've made in this video is so astonishing that I have to recognize, you know, that perhaps it's time for a little retreat into the wow. How are we doing? Oh, it's 1 hour and 40 minutes. Definitely. Yeah. So here we go. This is Dharmic Wisdom. I could keep going. I'm on a roll. But I always said, what, 2 steps forward, 1 step back, right? You intentionally retreat, even though you're on a roll, because you recognize you've made so much progress. You're getting into new territory such that you need to take a little break and go into that singularity of wow and commit to that. This is, and structure a response to all the progress we've already made. Okay, so this is just the wisdom, Dharmic Wisdom here. So I'm going to cut it off at this point, the progress, even though I could make more. I feel like I'm capable of that, and instead put my energy and attention on the wow of, let's go right into that singularity of structure there. I have the wow. It's here. It's wonderfully abstract, but I have it. It's wonderful. I know my response already to the progress I've already made is wow. And I'm just going to rest in that. People say I should play golf. I keep meeting these people, golfers. They, oh yeah, you've been playing recently. Oh, you should go there. And I keep saying, well, that's a sign I should play. But I said, not today. You know, we're just going great here. Just awesome. Maybe they're saying, can we tempt you into something lesser, you know, than you want? Is that what the world is doing? And I'm saying, no, no. For some reason, I keep saying no. Don't want to go there. Even though it's cheap, I could go there. I said, God, if you really want me to play golf, put me on a course that I really love. All right? How about that? So it's hard to discern. Sometimes it's difficult to discern these events that take place. You meet people, and there's a couple of different people have mentioned the same golf course. You should go there. So I'm saying, yeah, it's cheap. I could go there. But I've never liked going there, really. It's just not my vibe. You know, it's not my place. I don't want to go back to my home course because it's really not my place anymore. I'm in a transition right now, so I don't know what to do in that regard. But Holy Spirit will make it clear. There are some courses that I would play. I'd be willing to play because it has the right sort of ambience to it. I feel like it really doesn't matter how I play. I'm just here just looking at the beauty of it. And it's just an excuse to go to this course, actually. Rather than, I want to go out there and really play great on this lousy course. No, I'm not interested in that. I'd rather go out and play lousy on this beautiful course that I love. That's what I did about a little over a month ago. It was just so beautiful. I didn't really care. Where's my ball? I said, I don't really care. I don't really care where my ball went. Because look at this lake. Look at this pristine lake. And it's just, this mountain, and it's everything's reflecting, and it's just beautiful. Everywhere you look, it's just gorgeous parkland and beauty. they just say, oh my gosh, there's just no commotions at all. Nobody's pushing me at all. I was the only person out there. It was so hot, there's nobody else out there. Marshall says, nobody else out there. You're by yourself. You're all alone out there. I said, oh, great. So I smacked the ball. I said, well, that's out there somewhere. I don't know where it is. If I don't find it, I say, ah, drop another ball, you know. It's too beautiful to bother looking for your ball. Just, you know, let it be. Someone else will find it. Drop another one. Play another shot. Oh, that one's gone too. Oh, well, you know, it's great. Let's just, great, more time to look at the scenery. Like that. Interesting. It's almost better to be a lousy golfer, actually. Because then there's no pressure. Like, oh, I'm just going out to have a good time. And then the people, they have a great time. Whereas if you're out there trying to be a really good golfer, you're only focused on your ball and what's happening with your ball, and you're not really enjoying the ambience. The other thing would be, you're such a good golfer that you don't really care. There's nothing to prove. And so you could, you know, you just smack it around and you're not even worried about anything else, really. You're not worried about score, or ball, whatever. I lost the ball, whatever. You know, that's not going to hurt my swing. Interesting. Yeah, but I'm hitting that bad. That's great. My ball ended up in this lotus pond. Awesome. Really. That's what happened. I actually chunked two. I hit this ball that went in the water from a long distance. It went in the water. So I walked over to it was just gorgeous where I was. It was out of the ordinary, off the beaten path. It was just so beautiful. And I just stood there for a while just saying, yeah, wow, thank you. I thanked myself for hitting the ball in the water there. It was great. So then I dropped, and I hit another one, and that went in the water too. And I said, great, I get to stay here even longer. You see how that works? Instead of getting furious at myself, so that ruined my score, you know. I've taken like a quadruple bogey on this hole. It's horrible. I'm a terrible golfer. What happened? I thought I was good. I was saying, thank you, God. Wow. I couldn't hit a better shot that my life depended on. I put another one in the water. And now I get to watch this beautiful water and hang out here for a little while longer. And I finally hit one to the back of the green or something. And I said, ah, okay, back to golf. Kind of knock it in the hole. So I had these wonderful interludes. And my partners kept hitting it in weird in places, too. I got to go search for the ball in beautiful places with them. This is my friend that I met there. Never seen it before, but I called my friend because he hit two shots in this gorgeous river. Yeah, this, and we get to go look for the ball there. And it was so beautiful. Ducks there and waterfalls here and lotuses and flowers. And I'm like, where's your ball? I'm walking all over the place like I'm looking for his ball. I know it's in the water, but I'm looking for it. But what I'm really looking is like, oh, how beautiful this is. I get to like walk around this area. That's great. And then what did he do? He finally fished it out and hit another one, went in the water again. I get to look for it again. I said, oh, thank you. So it was great to have a bunch of hackers. When the course is beautiful, you want a bunch of hackers, you know? And you want some also that hit beautiful shots too, because that's fun also. So maybe I can play that role. It just hit these, you know, tremendously high, majestic crushes. Just, they feel like I'm flying up in the air. This is all of, it's beautiful. But don't worry about your score. You know, just hit great shots. You know, and maybe just get up there and don't grind over your putt so much. Just step up and putt it. So I think what people don't like is when you're obsessed about your score. So I really haven't practiced my putting much. I just want it to be good enough. You know, really I should practice just lag putting short putting, lag putting. Just get up there, knock it close, knock it in the hole. If you miss, knock it in and take your bogey, whatever. But hit beautiful shots. Yeah, okay, that this is a nice way I'm looking at it now. Because when you try to be a, you know, Joe Pro out there, and you're like, you got like a 4-foot putt, and you're spending like 3 minutes grinding on it, walking around the hole, checking the grain and everything, and like your whole life depends on making this putt. When you miss it, like you're cursing yourself, it's like, ah. That really turns everybody else off out there. You know, this is not a PGA tournament. There's not a $1.5 million on the line. So I have to realize this. I have to say, and same with the driver, your shots. Don't spend 3 minutes grinding over them. You know, get up there and crush it. Just stand up there and crush it. And don't, like, obsess about your game, your score. Because hardly anybody out there can play well, actually. And it just makes them feel uncomfortable. And they think that now we're caught up in this guy really wanting to play well. And, but if you have the power, go up there and display it. You know, just hit these absolute rocket shots. And, you know, if you can't hit great shots, everybody loves to see a great shot. But don't grind over anything. Be laughing, in a good mood, joking, that kind of thing. And help everybody search for their ball, you know, and help them out. And then that gives you opportunity to, yeah. Because you really don't have to find it. You know, it's not your ball. They're the ones that have to deal with it ultimately. You do the best to find it. And I, a lot of times I do find the ball because I just ask the ball, where are you? And people are amazed that I'm able to find the ball so well. I just say, well, you know, I just kind of asked, you know. I said, wow, thanks. How'd you find it? You're really good at finding golf balls. Because I'm tromping through all this wilderness. I'm thinking, oh, this is fun. I love tromping through wilderness. Huh, that's a different paradigm, isn't it? Interesting. So quickly, set up your shot, know what shot you're going to hit, get up there, and then just absolutely crush it, and then laugh with everyone, and then go find it. And, you know, get your yardage, okay, you know, your turn, hit your shot. Go where it goes and get on the green, and then, okay, line it up, and knock it towards the hole, and get in the hole, and move on to the next one and keep everybody laughing and joking and focused on the ambience, you know, instead of, you know, I have to make a score. I've got to break 80. I've got to break 90. I've got to do this. But, you know, I've got to be important. You know, I've got to I've got to affirm my importance in some way by a score. Wow. That's really a revolutionary way of looking at it. Wow. As everybody goes out there for the camaraderie anyway, they kind of want to lose their self-importance out there, most. And when you get someone who's just uptight about their score, it makes everybody uptight. Usually I don't even keep score. A lot of people don't even keep score. That's not what they're out there for. Interesting. Wow. So I remember that situation with my friend who got so mad about his score, was so obsessed about it, and he couldn't stand for me to get a lower score. It just would ruin his week, his month. He wouldn't talk to me for a month if I had a lower score than him. So I was on this one golf course with him, and it was my first chance to break 80. I had a nice, easy two-putt to break 80, to shoot 79, lowest score I've ever shot. And he was absolutely fuming, and he was saying, miss it. You know, like, he could just tell, he's like, you got to miss it. You got a three putt, you know. You can't break 80. And I realized he'd probably never talk to me again if I two putted for 79. And so I three putted. I sabotaged myself. So I did still have the camaraderie, some camaraderie there, but he was still fuming, you know, that I'd shot so well. And ultimately, I didn't play with him again. But maybe, actually, he taught me a lesson. And I have yet to learn it, you know. I've sort of learned it. And that is, stop worrying about your score. Stop trying to play so well. Stop competing, you know. Hit some bad shots on purpose if it lightens the mood. How does that hurt your capability? You know, if you have a great swing, why does it hurt you? Drive it into the rough or hit into the lake or something. And actually, people love shots hit into the lake. They say, it's a beautiful shot. I love that shot. Like I hit the palm tree on 18 last time I played, and everybody got a huge kick out of that. They just really were jumping all over the place with laughter. He said, what a great shot that was, man. You absolutely drilled that palm tree. It was exciting. I loved it too. I laughed at everybody else. I said, wow, it's my best shot of the day. So, I mean, you should be able to do some of that on purpose, really. It loosens things up. Especially if you hit it really well. Nobody wants to be intimidated out there. So, you know, hit one like a mile into a lake or something. So they say, the ball died a hero there, you know. Absolutely died a hero out there. And they like you to take risks and chances too out there. You know, if you always play safe, it's like, who does he think he is, you know? Say, come on, go for it. But of course, that's counter to our spiritual practice here of playing it safe at all costs. But the other golfers, they don't like that. So interesting, an interesting conundrum. If you're just this real boring, safe golfer, always plays the percentages and everything, nobody really wants to play with you like that. I don't know. I've never been able to figure it out exactly, you know, what style to play. So I asked the Holy Spirit, you know, what style do you want me to play? Because if you're laying up, you're going for score. See, if you go for it, you're going for the camaraderie. I don't know. Died a hero. You know, he died a hero. I don't know. Who wants to die a hero, you know? Everybody loves Phil Mickelson, the most popular guy, because he dies a hero all the time. Greg Norman, the same way. I got so mad at those guys. I said, you're so stupid. I can obviously tell you're going to die a hero by trying this shot. You could win the tournament if you just lay up. But they would refuse to lay up. They say, no, I'm going to die a hero. Because people love it. Love everyone who dies a hero. Because that's the secular world. Is, you know, die a hero. Be one of us and die a hero. It'll be better on the other side anyway. So maybe I better not do that. Maybe a combination, you know, of playing it safe, and in some instance, you know, hit a bad shot or something. Or certainly just don't care too much about your score. Just play it safe, but also don't fixate on grinding over your shots or anything. We'll see what comes up. It's really a conundrum of how do you present yourself in this world? How does Dharmic culture present themselves in this world to secular culture? Because there's really no negotiations between the two at all. You either choose one or the other. If you're not Dharmic, you're secular. If you're not secular, you're Dharmic. There's really no third condition at all. Except secular culture keeps trying to say negotiating a third condition. It says, God will have, you'll be happy. We'll be prime creator, but you'll be worshiping us, and that'll make you happy. And then everybody will be happy. So that's, see, it's not just us, God, being, you know, and it's not just you. It's about both of us, except we're now the new prime creator. So that's a third option, you see. No, it's not. It's the original second option of us trying to change reality and be prime creator. That's exactly what it is. It's not a third option. It's not a third option. So maybe that's why I don't play, is because I'm not sure what style to play. And if I get out there and not know what style to play, I will panic. So I still haven't resolved this issue. You know, what style should I play? Wow. Just like I have not resolved the issue, how does it present, you know, Dharmic culture here? What style, how do you play it? It's non-negotiable, for sure. But what a relief for those who want to be Dharmic, that Dharmic culture presents itself as non-negotiable, because that's how you succeed at dropping this nonsense that we need to, that we fixated the mind, and then therefore we have to figure out how to unfixate it. So, you know, the secular culture says, well, the challenge is, how do we unfixate the mind? You know, we're not quite sure how we do it because we can't figure out exactly how we did it. So first we have to figure out how we did it so that we can undo it. That's exactly what they're saying. So I leave it to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, what style do you want me to play? You know, how do you want me to play it? And you can show me in the golf, you know, how do you want me to play it? Because, yeah, if I don't have a style, I feel this panic within me. I get real nervous because I don't know, how should I play it out here? So, great question to look at it. Don't even know how should I dress? You know, should I dress like, yeah, one of the guys, and I'm just here to be a goofball? Or should I dress like PGA pro and say, I'm out here to score real low, you know? How do you play it? How is it played? Or just don't play golf at all? But that, you know, that kind of avoids the question. And that's like just don't be Dharmic at all. Well, that you know, is not helpful. I mean, how do we be Dharmic here? Okay, I just got an answer. The answer is practice your 7-iron. There you go. Holy Spirit threw a curveball there, but it's told me that before. Practice your 7-iron. Wow. Not what I expected, right? But yeah, there it is again. As it keeps saying that, practice your seminar. Wow, there you go. So really, what I could do is I could choose whatever I hit off the tee, so it leaves me like 150 to the hole. You know, and then just hit and just hit a 7-iron every hole, and just try to hit a 7-iron as much as possible. And of course, you wouldn't necessarily hit be the right shot or something, but just hit 7-iron out there for an iron. Wow! So it's a completely different way of looking at it. So if a hole's like 330 yards or something, you have to leave yourself 150. Hit it what? What did I say? 300. Well, if it's three, let's say 350 yards. Hit it 200. So, you might be able to hit a driver and hit it 300, and you only have 50 yards. But instead, I'd hit it 200 yards. I'd hit like a 2 hybrid, and hit it out there to something or whatever. And then even if I had like 130, I still hit a 7-iron. Just take a little bit off of it. It's to get like really, really good with a 7-iron. Wow, that's a brilliant strategy. Brilliant strategy. And you wouldn't be playing that good because you'd be laying up here and you know, people would say, oh, you know, he's cautious, he's not so good, he's not sure what club to hit, and he's hitting a 7-iron, not so good. And so they just, I don't know what he's doing, really. It's just... Sometimes cautious, sometimes he goes where I can't really figure it out, you know. Just doesn't really know what he's doing that much, which is fine. He can still have the camaraderie, but I already know what I'm doing out there. So even if I have like 120 yards, I'll take a 7-iron and try to just smooth it in there. And so get really confident with that 7-iron. Even 160, try to hit a 7-iron. You know, just come up, oh, I came up short. You know, came up short. Oh, I'm struggling out here a little bit. Wow, that's beautiful. Because once that 7-iron is dialed in, the Holy Spirit said you'll feel different about yourself. So there's a very, very novel approach. I hadn't thought of it before. Wow. I like that. Even hit that 7-iron off the tee in certain times, you know. I might be going a little too far. But that would teach you, you know, how to modify your swing a little bit so you don't hit it so hard, or to go all in, or just, so it like teach you a lot about the game by just using that one iron, as you know, as much as possible. And that's how you get good. That's how, yeah. Holy cow. Thank you, Holy Spirit. That's a very, very wise decision, advice you gave. So you see, if you turn something over genuinely to the Holy Spirit, you say, you know, really, I really need help on this. I'll listen to what you say. And I'm willing now to consider it. It just totally flipped everything for me. That wasn't what I thought I was looking at. You know, I gave these two options to the Holy Spirit. But it saw something, it saw it in a different way. And really it's saying, what you need to be is you need to be really relaxed out there and trust in yourself. And when you are relaxed and trust yourself, that helps everybody else you're with. They're going to feel relaxed and trust in themselves more. Okay? And you can't do that yet because you're not comfortable with that 150, 150 to 130, 160 to 130 area. And you have to be able to handle that with your, you know, 7-iron. Make that your favorite club. Make that your favorite club. Even pitch with it, you know, just really make that your favorite club. And when you can handle those distances, 160 to 130 kind of, those distances, then all the rest of your game will just smooth out because you already have everything else. That's the problem area. So just become really strong at that. And then you'll just be relaxed and calm. And you say, whatever, you know, whatever comes, it's fine. I've got it covered. And that'll reassure everybody else out there. Whereas they can then truly relax and maybe not be so goofball, but really focus on the beauty of everything and say, you know what, there's something beyond being goofball. Yeah. Wow. All right, this is a start. This is a start then. Commit to that. Commit to that. I won't even hit the other clubs right now. I know I can hit them. I know I have the power. So I don't. Why do I need to do something I know I can do, but I don't know that I can hit the 7 iron, you see? So do focus on that, the weak area. Hallelujah. There you go. So I still have some steps to take. Maybe I can take one today, actually. Possible, yeah. Maybe I will. Maybe I will just give that a try and start working on it. Just start working on it. Why not? Why not? So, wow. So great taping here. And then great resolution to recognizing, hey, there's some practice I need to do that, you know, I'm weak on. But this will really just and smooth everything else out. No more panic. No more panic. I'm going to try it. I'll try it. I'll try it. I'm going to give it a try. See how it goes. All right. Very great. The new way is wow. The new way is wow. The new way is wow.